Okay, everybody. Well, welcome. Good night. Not good night. Good evening. My name is Paul O'Neill. On behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, I'd like to welcome everybody here to our this month's presentation in our series. And tonight's subject is one that truly defined Kingston, the D&H Canal. It really is the Kingston that we know really was created by the D&H Canal. So we're going to jump right in because our feature presenter, William Merchant, has a lot to talk about. And as I discussed with Bill as we were moving towards tonight, this is really a subject that we should have featured much earlier in our series. Because the D&H Canal is truly the spring from which all rivers run. Most of the subjects that we've featured in the past owe their prominence, they owe their fame, to a very simple decision made by Maurice Wurtz and a few others to locate the terminus of the D&H Canal here in Kingston. The history of Kingston would be vastly different than that that we appreciate today without the D&H Canal being here. And we are truly fortunate tonight to have as our feature presenter William Merchant. Bill is the president of the D&H Canal Historical Society Museum, and he is a preeminent authority on all things canal. So it is truly an honor to be able to introduce to you as our feature presenter tonight, William Merchant.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. As Paul has pointed out, I'm the president of the D&H Canal Historical Society and Museum in High Falls. I'm also the vice chair of the Delaware and Hudson Transportation Heritage Council, which is an umbrella group of both museums and cultural institutions and individuals concerned with the history of the D&H Canal and in preserving what is left of it, which we're very fortunate to have great bits of the canal still extant along its entire route. A little bit about myself first. I grew up in Albany. I mainly work as a double bass luthier. I'm also I repair big musical instruments. And I'm lucky enough to make High Falls my home since 1995 when I bought a vernacular post and beam house said to be made in 1820 right on Berm Road. In canal parlance, the berm is this, it's interesting because a berm as we know it today is it's a man-made mound, but in canal parlance, there were two sides to the canal. There was the towpath, which is where the animals pulling the boats would go, and then there was the berm side, and as it happens, the towpath was actually a man-made berm probably a good 90% of the time, and very often the berm side was just an accident of topography. It would, generally speaking, be the side of the stream. So I bought this house on Berm Road. They said 1820. As our local historian Bill Cullen pointed out, they really don't know the dates of those houses. I'm inclined to believe that my house was probably built closer to 1825 when the canal came through, because it was sited right on the canal, and really points up, people immediately grasp the significance of having something like a canal come through. The D&H Canal, for those of you who haven't been there, is a wonderful resource. We've got great archives. The 80 some odd slides that you're going to see tonight come from the pictures in our archives. We've also got a really great collection of canal memorabilia. If I do say so myself, I think it's the best of the many institutions concerned with the D&H Canal. It's open seasonally these currently May through October on weekends, but we also administer the 5-block walk, which is open 24/7, 365 days a year, 366 on leap years. And if you've never checked it out, I really encourage you to do so. So I always like, when I talk about the D&H Canal, I like to start at the War of 1812. When we were at war with England, all of a sudden we used to import all of our coal, the soft bituminous coal. 95% of American coal came from England, but the War of 1812 put an end to that. Meanwhile, we had some bituminous coal in Virginia, but the War of 1812 also, the blockades meant that coal wasn't getting moved much out of Virginia. But in Pennsylvania, there was anthracite coal, which is hard coal. In fact, they called it stone coal. And it wasn't at first believed that you could burn it, but by the Revolutionary War, there were people using it. Blacksmiths around the Philadelphia area, in particular, were aware that this anthracite coal burned very, very long and hard, very clean and longer. So you got a good hot fire that lasted a long time. And in fact, a guy by the name of, I think, Jesse Fell had a nail factory in the Philly area that used anthracite coal. And somewhere in the early 19th century, I believe 1808, he designed a grate that allowed you to get the trick of burning this stuff was to get enough oxygen around it. And so he built a grate that was taller and higher so that you could actually burn this stone coal. The other thing about the War of 1812, there was Morris and William Wurtz. I know that Paul called them Maurice, and it's spelled that way, but indications are they probably pronounced it Morris. So that's one of those trick things now that people, you know, somebody who really knows about the canal knows that it's Morris Wurtz. The Wurtz brothers were Philadelphia dry good merchants, and they had a government contract to supply uniforms to the American soldiers. As part of their payment, they got some land in Pennsylvania, the Wyoming Valley, that had this stone coal on it. They also, it's interesting, the histories both mention it being gotten from the government. They also, a guy by the name of David Nobles had a debt with them, and he gave them some land as well. So the brothers found themselves with this coal and weren't sure yet what to do with it. People would move it to Philadelphia, but there was an awful lot of coal in Philadelphia. It kills me to read the histories. The way that they moved the coal down the river, the Delaware River, they built a one-way ark out of wood, filled it with coal, and if successful, basically it was like a pallet. They would sell the wood at the other end because they couldn't get the boat back up the flow of the river. They could only go one direction in it. So the Wurtz brothers brought a little bit of coal to Philadelphia, but Philadelphia was awash with coal, so they got thinking that they had to have some other way and some other market. So this brings us to DeWitt Clinton. DeWitt Clinton was known as the father of the Erie Canal. He was governor during its time and really pushed it through. I never thought about the Erie Canal really made, it opened up the entire west of the continent, because America was a much smaller country back then. You know, beyond the Mississippi was still a wilderness, so people really didn't. So once you got to the Erie Canal, you got to Buffalo, you got to the Great Lakes, you got to Chicago and to the Mississippi. You got to the Missouri River. You got as far west as anybody had been besides the Native Americans. So this is a picture in the collection now of the D&H Canal of DeWitt Clinton holding the charter for the D&H Canal Company. You can see it there. This originally was in the hotel here in Kingston called the DeWitt Clinton, and then went to, I believe it was the Ulster County Bar Association, who eventually gave it to us. It's probably Ezra Ames. There's some talk that possibly John Vanderlyn, but I can say, looking at the hands on this painting and all the hands here, Vanderlyn was a better painter. I'm pretty sure that the Ezra Ames attribution is correct. I plan to spend a little time in Albany sometime just to look at some Ames to see. So the brothers get it in their heads they've got to go find a market for their coal. They realize that New York City is a growing town and a natural market, because it didn't have the advantages of Philadelphia's for the other coal producers in the region. The coffee houses in the 18th and 19th century were places where men of business and men of money would meet and look for business opportunities. Wall Street, well, by 1825, Wall Street started being known as the Wall Street of today. But prior to this, coffee houses were the places where you went to find investors. In fact, the Tontine Coffee House is mentioned in Washington Irving's biography of George Washington. So the brothers went and did some finagling with the legislatives, got permission from both Philadelphia and New York to build a canal. And the route that they chose was through the along the Laxawaxen River, through the Delaware, and then up what eventually becomes the Rondout Valley, and coming out here in Kingston. And that was also an accident of geography, if you will. In fact, Newburgh wanted to see the canal terminate there, realizing the advantages that it would bring to the local economy to have it, but there was the Shawangunk Mountains are in the way. They even postulated a 2-mile-long tunnel through the Shawangunk Mountains. And politically, while they were, they had to take these ideas seriously because people of means that lived in the various towns were subscribers eventually. And so if somebody brought up an idea like, oh, go through Newburgh, they actually had engineers talk about it a little bit. But really, it had to come through here. So famously, on January 27th of 1825, they got permission to start a canal company and bank. A bank because a lot of companies at the time would use banking as a short-term way to get stockholder value, if it were a way to produce money. You know, if you're going to build a canal, it's going to take you some time to build it. But if you want, you're asking for money, banking was a way for people to make profits quickly to keep their stockholders happy. So they had a 20-year ability to make their own banknotes. In fact, we have a $3 bill in our collection that was issued by the canal company. So famously, on that one day, January 27th, 1825, they sold out over $1 million of stock at the Tontine Coffee House. They also had subscriptions opened here in Kingston and in Goshen. So they tried to keep it regional, but probably most of the money came through New York City. So America didn't have engineers, per se. There wasn't a school. There was no way to learn engineering in the early 19th century. But the Erie Canal became a way for people to learn engineering. And so the most famous engineer of his day was the head engineer of the Erie, Benjamin Wright, who went on. He was considered, just about anybody who built a canal would want to get this man. And it was his proteges that also went on to become famous. Most of the railroad engineers made their bones first as canal engineers. So the Wurtz brothers knew the Rondout Valley from hunting trips, apparently. And so they had an idea of which way it would go, but they actually had Benjamin Wright, who also farmed it out to other people because, as I say, he was in so demand. But here you've got the route that was finally selected for the D&H Canal. It's 108 miles from Honesdale, Pennsylvania, to Rondout here on the right on the Hudson. And then you're still, 70 miles from New York City. You're a tidewater, but then you still have quite a ways to go. But the geography was such that any other route would have required way too many locks, way too much up and down. As it was, I believe it's got about 1,000-foot lift from beginning to end. That's how much mountains they had to get up and over. So Benjamin Wright being busy, he quickly enlisted John Jervis, who made his bones on the Erie Canal. In fact, lived along the route, was a farmer's son, and just started working on the canal for Benjamin Wright. But he was a smart guy, and he did what he was asked and kept quiet and kept his eyes open and ears open. And he learned to be quite an engineer. In fact, he later goes on to work for a number of railroads. He's the chief engineer of the D&H for the first 5 or 6 years, I think. Don't hold me to it. He also designed the Croton Reservoir and Aqueduct for New York City. So he was a man that had an awful lot of influence in both canals and railroads. And the town of Port Jervis was named after him. A lot of the towns got named as favors along that route. So you've got Honesdale was named for Philip Hone, who was the first president, a very influential a man for the canal, although he was only president for 1 year. He went on to become mayor of New York, and then, although he, for his entire life, he held a lot of stock in the canal company. There's even a story in the 1830s that he bailed out the company with his own money. We have no proof of this. It may be apocryphal, but he was very influential. So they named Honesdale, the town that grew up along this route, after him. Port Jervis was named for John Jervis. Wurtzboro was named for the Wurtz brothers. They actually named Port Ewan Bolton after John Bolton, who was a less than successful president for the D&H, and that's one name that didn't stick. But basically, these towns there weren't any towns until the canal came through. Other people that were also worked as engineers: James McEntee, Horatio Allen, James Archibald, John Mills, and John Clark, who was later a New York State engineer. James McEntee may be known to you, Kingston history aficionados, as the father of Jervis McEntee and Julia McEntee Dillon, two very famous 19th century painters. In fact, I wouldn't wonder if there might not be a Jervis McEntee somewhere in this building. And I'm almost positive there's at least one of Julia Dillon McEntee's paintings as well. So construction began in the fall of, they get this money in January. They, it takes them a while to work out the route. In fact, there was even in the Kingston area, they had two choices. They could follow the Rondout Valley, or they could have followed what was called the old mine road, Route 209, all the way up into the Esopus. And there was some desire to go that way because there was more towns already, and you'd be giving the existing infrastructure a boost. But ultimately, geography won out, and the route became to Rondout rather than through Kingston proper, much to Rondout's. Rondout becomes a town because of this. All along the canal route, we have contemporary accounts where there'd be a farm, two farms in these areas. Within 6 months, whole towns would spring up. The second people knew that there was going to be a canal in the area, people realized what this was going to mean. Roads at the time were pretty rough affairs. You had turnpikes, so people would get permission to charge funds if they clear out a path through the woods. Very often these turnpikes would follow Indian routes that had been used by the native peoples for hundreds, if not thousands of years. But what they would do is they would apparently just chop down the trees for enough of the axles to clear the stumps. And so Teamsters, a friend of mine recently, when I used the phrase, Teamsters were the guys running the teams of oxen that were pulling the goods on wagons, but they wouldn't ride on the wagon. It was way too rough a ride. And even when they made things like plank roads, you'll see around the area of a road called Plank Road, they literally were made of just planks of wood laid down, but they were just bumpy. I imagine there was bark side up. So roads were pretty horrible. We really didn't have great transportation in America in the beginning of the 19th century. In fact, when the Erie opened up, it said that the cost of shipping freight along it dropped to 10%. So what cost you a dollar on the roads of the day cost you 10 cents to move the same distance on a canal. So America was really canal fever. In the early 19th century, railroads really hadn't taken hold yet. It was the going technology. Washington himself had stock in some canal companies down Virginia Way, and people were all, this was a big deal. This was like the internet in its time, the topic being prosperity. This was a way to help your area to get your goods to market and stuff. So the construction begins. It takes them about 2.5 years. They couldn't work when the ground was frozen, or at least do too much. They were working. It was just men, shovels, and to some degree they had animals animals, certainly for pulling big stumps and the like. There were machines invented for stump pulling and the like. When they were working out the route, James McEntee discovered cement in the High Falls area. I think it's always sort of, being that I live in High Falls, Rosendale cement really wasn't found in Rosendale. It was found first in High Falls. But, right? But the fact is, there was a lot more of it in Rosendale, but they were going to actually bring in cement on the Erie Canal from Chenango, where Canvas White discovered cement along the Erie route, and originally the D&H people were going to move their cement along the Erie down the Hudson to here, but luckily discovered cement. And in fact, it's the same Canvas White whose family White poured in Rosendale, where eventually there was cement works as well. We'll talk a little bit more about the cement industry later. So it took them less than 3 years to build a canal 108 miles long with 108 locks. That actually is just an accident. It's not like there was a lock every mile. You had, in High Falls, we've got 7 or 8 locks all in a row, and then there's the 17-mile summit level that's all at one level, at the highest point in the canal, basically between I'm going to say the Neversink River and Wurtzboro. There's a 17-mile level where it's no locks for the entire 17 miles. And they claimed that the water flowed both ways there, because on the western and southern end of it, you were coming up from the Delaware, so the water flowed towards the Delaware. And starting at Wurtzboro, the water now starts to flow downhill as you're making your way into the Hudson Valley, into the Rondout Valley, and then into the Hudson Valley. And water was a problem all along. I mean, it's amazing. This was gravity-fed. It was. They didn't have any technology. They didn't have steam shovels. It was just men with shovels, animals to help pull, wagons of stuff. They had wheelbarrows. They also did have This is a scoop out of our collection that was actually found, I believe, on the Five Locks Walk. You could see, you could hook a team up to that ring that the gentleman's holding there and move a little bit more material than a guy might want to move, and certainly it probably beat a wheelbarrow. It was largely built by, it was originally, I'll get to the next slide. It was the original specifications, like so many of these big transportation improvements, like the Transcontinental Railroad. Originally, they kind of built them as big as they needed to without going crazy, in essence, just big enough to do the job. So it was originally 4 feet deep, 20 at the bottom, and 32 feet at the top. And the boats that it could accommodate were 20 to 30 tons. And in fact, in the first couple of years, they had a lot of trouble keeping water in it. They actually filled it two or three times and drained it and let it settle to let the bottom settle. But there were sections that they had to do what they called puddling. They'd line it with clay. And it took them a while to get it to hold water. And in fact, the first two or three years, they couldn't actually even put 30 tons in the boats that they had because they couldn't keep enough water in it. And all along it, I mean, again, 108 miles of waterway and all gravity fed. So they were wherever there's a stream that would come by, they would go and pull a feeder canal. And you just pulled water wherever you could pull it. But they managed to open late in the season in October of 1828. One of the problems with canals, and I'll discuss it a little later, is that they would ice up, and our winters used to be more severe. The Hudson used to freeze solid. And so if you're lucky, you could run the canal from April till maybe November or early December on a warm year. But the very first year, they actually ran more cordwood and firewood than coal along it. Although the D&H company was created because they owned the coal lands, and throughout its 75-year run, it was all about the coal, and that was the main commodity that it moved. That was the reason that it was built. But it also, because it was there, it was used by other people. So another problem they had is that the coal was located in what quickly became called Carbondale, which was the other side of a, I'm going to say 900-foot Moosic Mountains. And so they had to get the coal across. And in fact, in the early years, first two or three years at least, they actually they invested in a local turnpike road, and they brought all their coal over on wagons with teams. Another reason why they probably didn't get to move as much coal on the canal as they could have. So they quickly realized there was a scheme. One of the engineers, I believe John Sullivan, had a really complicated elevator lift that, if you see the pictures of it, you can see why it was never built. Ultimately, they decided to use a railroad. Now, railroads in 1825, England was just starting to work with steam engines. Railroads were tracks laid down with rail cars like we know them, but they were usually pulled by animals. In this case, so the D&H basically made a railroad that went up over the Moosic Mountains and then back down into Honesdale. It's referred to as a gravity railroad, but in fact, it wasn't until two or three expansions of it that it was truly a gravity railroad. On a gravity railroad, they would actually use the weight of the loaded cars to pull the light cars back up the other side. So you're dropping down towards Honesdale, you're pulling the other ones back, and vice versa. But in fact, they used animals and later steam engines. They originally, I believe it was John Jervis, had them use chain to pull these cars, but they had a lot of trouble with the chain, with the chains breaking. Jervis blames the iron makers of the time, and that's probably the case. But the fact is, as appealing as chains were, they went over to rope, which they also had problems with the ropes breaking. But you know, when you had a railway car that breaks, they did have brakes on them if there was somebody on it. But you know, you would lose the load and the car if you weren't careful. But eventually, they got a very sophisticated. There's a whole history of the gravity railroad. I can barely wrap my brain around the gravity railroad. They did so many different things. Hopefully this year, there's a gentleman who's in the DHTHC with me, who heads the museum in Carbondale, who I'm hoping to get do a talk on the gravity, because he's been working on a book on it. But it was a pretty fascinating thing. Here's a picture of the gravity right down at Honesdale, I believe it is, where the terminus, where the canal actually began. So one of the other, the D&H Canal likes to call itself the first million-dollar enterprise in America. And in fact, of the six or seven canals in New York State, it was one of only, I believe, two that were privately funded, which isn't to say they didn't take money. They took some money from Pennsylvania, they took some money from New York, and they had a lot of political wrangling to do, because You know, the people in Philadelphia didn't want to do something, but ultimately, this benefited the people in New York. At the time, Philly was really the big town in America. New York was ascendant, but by no means assured to be the biggest city in America as it is today. So the other first that the D&H had is that they ran the first steam engine on U.S. soil. And this is a picture of it reconstructed. It's in the Smithsonian today, called the Storbridge Lion. They sent an engineer who wasn't even working for them anymore by the name of Horatio Allen, who was a protege of John Jervis's, and I think also might have spent a little time in the Erie. Horatio Allen later spends most of his career as an engineer working for railroads throughout the 19th century. They paid him to go over to England and investigate steam engines. And a guy by the name of Rastrick, I believe it is, and Stevenson were just starting to experiment. I think later in this, in that same decade, the first steam engine finally actually runs on tracks in England. But here in America, they brought over four steam engines. This one, the Starbridge Lion, famously ran the rails on the gravity, but there was some confusion. It came in overweight. And the railways of the time were simply hemlock with metal strapping over the top of it. So the specifications that Jervis had sent Horatio over to England with was for an engine weighing about 5 tons, fully loaded. You got to figure the water for the steam had to factor in too. It takes up some weight. Well, the Storbridge Lion wound up at 7.5 tons. And so they ran it, I think, twice. But it's technically the very first steam engine ever run on American soil, and another first for the D&H company. Interesting too, because the companies, they had no model. You know, how to run this sort of public conveyance. They really were, they sort of invented, you know, they become the model that railroads start to follow as far as administration and how they work this enterprise that stretches over these 108 miles. The Storbridge Lion now, they just took the steam engine, put it in a stationary building and used it at the top of one of the planes on the gravity railroad. So they would use steam power to pull up, the trains up the mountain. So it's on the gravity that they first make the acquaintance of John Roebling, a German immigrant who, he's credited with inventing wire rope, but there's also, I know people in Germany working on the same thing, but John Roebling made a factory in Pennsylvania, which to this day makes wire rope. And so John Roebling becomes sort of on the radar of the D&H company. I believe it's 1844, they buy wire rope from him and replace that troublesome hemp rope with wire rope on the gravity, and virtually from that time until the close of the canal in the gravity in 1899, the wire rope works out really well. And John Roebling, we're going to encounter him a little later in the talk because he has more to add to the whole thing. So, 2.5, almost 3 years, they've hand dug this ditch, built all these canals. It was all these locks and things. It was all done by local labor. So sections were contracted out. So already the prosperity, you've got this company that gets over $1.5 million of private money and immediately starts pumping it. They had to build this thing. So not only do towns grow up and their stores and all the auxiliary businesses, the farmers in the area now have a way to get stuff, goods to market, and the people along the way have employment. Both in building the canal and working on it. So the canal boats, now as you'll notice here, we're very lucky in the D&H Canal. I've got some 80 slides in this presentation. Photography gets invented in about 1845 and becomes fairly prevalent even by about 1850. So all of the pictures you're gonna see only show the biggest boats they ever ran. These are 130-ton boats. The earliest boats only carried 30 tons. So this thing becomes so successful. After sputtering along for about 4 or 5 years, it becomes a success, starts paying dividends, and they start enlarging it. And the history of the 1840s is largely about enlargement. But these are just some pictures from our archives. So here you've got, typically a boat was, very early on, the way that the D&H company ran the canal is that they owned the boats, they owned the horses, although eventually, in fact, pretty quickly, mules were favored because they worked harder and longer on less feed, so they were more economical to run. Probably the early boats could run with one animal, but again, any of pictures, you'll always see two animals because these big boats, the earliest boats had 30-ton capacity. By the middle of the 19th century, the boats have up to 130-ton capacity. So early on, the D&H company owned the boats, owned the mules. hire the men. Usually there were two men on the boat, and usually boys, young boys, very often orphans, who would run the team. So every boat had three teams, and there were up to, even early on, 400 boats or so, and I believe that it's Haiti, there were up to 1,000 boats running this canal. A lot of them affiliated with the D&H and some private boats as well. So here you see a crew of clearly more than just the crew of the boat. And here we've got a steam packet. There weren't many steamboats. Steamboats went too fast and wore down the sides of the canal. So there was the paymaster's boat, but here is what looks to be the boat reminds me of one of the paymaster's boat, but it obviously this is people on a little bit of a lark, which in the second half of the 19th century was more common. And here is a probably a put together scene of somebody inside the boat. So the people, the canalers, actually lived on their boats. But pretty quickly, the canal company found that it cost too much, it was too much to administer. By 1830, even, I'm gonna say, they started a plan where individuals could buy the boats, and the canal company just starts paying them to haul the coal. And this winds up being the model for about 70 years. It's a great model for the canal company. It's horrible for the canalers, because the canal company could, when they had excess, they'd slow down the boats. They really didn't do any favors for the canalers. It was a tough life. By the last 30 or 40 years, it was very often families that would buy a boat. So the canal company would sell you a boat, and the way that they would do it, the boats cost between $400 and $600 in the 19th century, depending on the types of boats they were. They would sell you a boat, and out of every load that you managed to take, they would take X amount of dollar, usually about $10 out of a load. And the trip took around 10 days, and depending on the weather, depending on if they could keep water in it, because one of the problems they would have, in drought years they wouldn't be able to run. Sometimes they had trouble, especially as they kept expanding, but one of the things they did is they started buying up ponds and even creating reservoirs, always above the level of the canal, because they didn't pump it. All this water was moved in by gravity. Here's another scene of a man whipped with the horses. And yet another, we have a lot of great pictures. I get a little carried away. And here is just a pleasure craft on possibly after the canal area, but possibly during it. And actually, by the way, this man could get in trouble here. He's poling his boat. You were not allowed to pole your boat. You might push your pole through the puddling on the bottom and create a leak. In fact, very often the canal company had to pay farmers for the damage they did flooding their fields. But anything, you know, the canalers would have a gun along, both to shoot at varmints for food, but also if you saw any sort of burrowing animal on the canal, you wanted them out of there. But you weren't allowed. You could get fined by the canal company for poling a boat. Now here you've got children. Here's a family probably. So the two kids up on the mules, with the mules with the feed baskets, and the family on the boat, the wife at the tiller. So they were smart guys. You can see here in this is Honesdale, the beginning of the run. So this is the other end of the gravity railroad. They've taken it up the Moosic Mountain and down on the gravity. They've got people handling this at each stop. So people had to, I don't know whether they were able to dump the coal cars or not, but you can see there's the coal cars up on the top, and gentlemen, they went into chutes. They filled the boats through gravity, which was really smart of them. So this is a shot of them loading up at Honesdale. And eventually they actually would break up the coal into various sizes as this fuel caught on, and it really did. America, even by the middle of the 19th century, was largely denuded of firewood. It was all cut down. So coal came just in time, and that's probably also why this was such a successful venture. So this is here in Kingston and Rondout. Look at all those piles of coal on Island Dock. So that actually, Island Dock was a peninsula, and you can see they cut, and you can see this to this day if you drive along down in the Rondout. There's a section of it. They actually made that island, cutting the canal through the peninsula there. But here's where they, so here they offloaded all the coal and then reloaded it onto boats to take it down to New York City. They also sent it to Albany, anywhere. In fact, one of the earliest loads they sent up to Albany to Governor-elect Van Buren, kind of probably for free. These guys knew, they were a company, they knew to grease the wheels, if you will, you know. And meanwhile, here on the other end, here's Jim Jackson, a shoveler for the canal company. This would have been probably in the last decade. And actually, by this point, they had boats big enough that they could actually raft them down the Hudson River, which was a real improvement. It meant that they didn't have to handle the coal. That was one less handling, one less manhandling. And again, these guys with shovels and wheelbarrows, they worked a lot harder than I've ever been willing to my whole life, personally. And here's another scene of the Rondout. So Rondout becomes a huge town because the canal company terminates the canal here. In fact, I believe my next, so here's another shot. And that's just a little canal scene I thought I'd throw in there for us to pause for a minute there. Oh. So lock tenders, the locks themselves were manned originally by two people. And so the canal company built 108 locks. Most of them were stone with wood lining, and that had to be periodically refurbished. In the off season, they drained the canal or sections of it, and they drained the locks, and the wood would, wherever it was punky or rotten, would have to be replaced. There were, here in High Falls, they used cut stone locks. That was part of the final enlargement of the canal, which I'll get to a little bit further along here. So here's the lock tender. This is later in, so that building that he's sitting by, in about 1859, I believe it is, they invest in this technology where they can go from one lock tender from two lock tenders to one. So it used to take a guy at either end. Here we've got a permit for a boat to operate on the canal. And just the scene of a lock. I assume you all know how the locks work. You know, water comes in at one level. They fill it all up and raise it up to the next level. They were typically eight foot of lift and drop. And if the canal was busy enough, you'd have a boat going in each direction. You'd have a loaded boat going east and north towards Rondout, and you'd have empty boats going back for another load. And so you'd round robin. So the canal itself was wide enough for at least two boats to pass, but the locks were just enough for one boat. You got to think the quantity of water that they had to just lock through. The five locks walk in High Falls, they've got all along it, every lock has got what they call a waste weir. And I was given a tour just a couple months ago, and I realized, you know, waste weir really doesn't tell the whole story. You had five, six, seven locks in a row there. Every time they locked through, that was a pretty bodacious amount of water. You needed to make sure you had enough water. So these waste weirs weren't for waste. They were just to keep water in the darn thing. The lock tender at each lock was responsible to make sure there was a head of water down to the next lock from his lock. They also employed watchmen, especially like on the 17-mile summit level. There were periodically buildings where people lived who just walked along to keep the critters out, to fix any minor breaks, and to just maintain the canal. If you didn't have water in the canal, you didn't have a roadway, you know. So the topic of my talk, if you will, economic development, you know, towns spring up, goods of all sorts are transported. You get to Albany, you get onto the Erie Canal, which means, as I was saying before, you get all the way to the west. You really get all the way to America. Once you're to New York City, you've got the Eastern Seaboard. So goods that came along the canal made it anywhere in America. In fact, I know Ellenville shoe leather, I'm told, in the Civil War, all made it out, was all shipped from Ellenville on the canal. Down to Washington, presumably. Here is, you can see that building on your right is the D&H offices. No longer extant, but I believe there's a group here, Joe could probably tell you more, Joe Tantillo. There's an Irish group that's going to build a building on, I think, the same spot and inspired by this same D&H building. And here is the M. Martin in Rondout. So this is during the steam era. So they quickly also, steamboats started using this anthracite coal as well. And the canal company was very savvy. They actually partnered with people. They really encouraged people. They tried a lot of things, anything to find a market for their coal, you know. But again, because cordwood, I forget, I believe steamboats could run on, the cost of the coal was half what it would be in wood. So it made economic sense for steamboats to use the D&H product. And the D&H Canal Company only, I think maybe, ever supplied 10%, I'm going to say, of the country's coal. There were a lot of other concerns, many of them that did the Skyle kill into Philadelphia. There was a lot of coal in the Wyoming Valley of Pennsylvania. I think there may still be. So one of the things that happened all along the canal, so much so that I didn't even bother trying to tell you how many towns, every town had boat building facilities. there were boat building facilities along the Erie, and in fact, some of the Erie boats made their way into the D&H Canal. This happens to be in creek locks. And again, we're only seeing, this is the 130-ton boats. We don't have pictures of any of the other any of the other boats. But what we do have in the museum is a model of the earliest boats. So I just thought, I couldn't get you a picture of one of the boats themselves, but this is a model of what was the smallest boat, what they later sort of derisively referred to as flickers. The canal company kept enlarging, and so people would take these smaller boats and do what they called hipping, where they'd actually add walls to the side so they could get a couple tons more of coal onto them. And these things early on ran 10 to 20 tons of coal, and once they had the canal up and running by 1830 or so, they could get a full 30 tons. And they moved eventually, I forget what the record, I think they might have done a million tons somewhere in there, but don't quote me on that either. Here again, we've got gentlemen working on the boats. There were boat yards too numerous, as I say, towns all along, Rondout and Creek Locks. There's a dry dock down in Sullivan County in Wurtzboro, Phillipsport had them, Port Jervis area. I mean, just, it was a big business. Another big business was Bluestone. And by 1850, this building is still extant down on the Rondout waterfront, the S&WB Fitch building. And this was a big Bluestone dock. By 1850, this company supplied half the Bluestone in America. Bluestone, for those of you who don't know, although you probably do, is an indigenous stone that's been mined more in the Woodstock area, not so much south, but in Ulster County. I think up in Greene County as well, but it made particularly good sidewalk and curbing. And in fact, much of New York City sidewalks, I was in Beacon over the summer walking along the street and looked down and said, that's my Bluestone, that came in on the canal. It's still extant. It's a wonderful material and still sought after. A very big industry, and one of the other industries that flourished because the canal was there to help them. And it's an amazing thing too, I live right in High Falls, and right down the street from me is Stone Dock Road, and there was a Bluestone loading dock there, and one of our local historians was like, why there? Well, a lot of the basins along the canal were just accidents of topography. You had the canal running through, and you might have the riverbank or that you're on, the side of the river might go this way. Well, you don't want to make the canal turn that way, so you just keep it a straight line. So you had your berm, which was away from the canal, from the river, and then on the river, the stream side, you had the man-made towpath. And if the berm side had a little jut in it, well, you just left it there. Later, people would come along and go, oh, great, this is a spot we can pull a boat over. So it seems the Bluestone industry was so successful. I know there was a Bluestone loading dock in Allegherville, but I don't know that there was much Bluestone being taken out that close. I think it was all further north. But it was efficient enough, most efficacious, I should say, for them to actually bring the stone to wherever they could build the docks, I think. Rosendale Cement. I'd like to, is it 75% of all of America's cement in the second half of the 19th century? Joe, I'm looking at you. I'm just from a tour I did of the Snyder Estate, an excellent local historical organization like our own. 75% of all of America's cement eventually was the so-called Rosendale cement that discovered in High Falls. So here's a picture of one of the many cement kilns. Any of you who have spent any time driving around have probably seen tons of these things, as well as the mines. It was using the Brooklyn Bridge, the Statue of Liberty, the Croton Reservoir, et cetera, et cetera. Here is a great picture of, you'll see these, you notice, there's I forget the exact name of this kind of mining, but they'd work a seam, and they would leave those pillars in to hold up and just extract around it. And you'll see on the new rail trail in Rosendale, you'll see sections of the mines open like this. You can also see this along the highways, right on 32, just south of Rosendale, there's a section, and along 213 in Rosendale. But here's a bunch of the miners. The bowler hat was the hard hat of its day. So you'll see people that work, which is amazing to me because there ain't that much protection, are they? You know, I'd like something a little harder than a bowler, please. You know, but here you go. These are typical cement workers of the day in Rosendale. I forget which of the mines that is, but and here they are. You might recognize the Wallkill Railroad Trestle, which is now the walkway over the Wallkill. I think it's been dubbed in Rosendale. And here they are loading. It looks like bags of cement here. But you can also see some barrels. And so here's a team loading up cement right in Rosendale. I love these old postcards. I believe this is a colorized photo. I don't think this is a drawing. But it almost looks like a watercolor at that point, doesn't it? So that's what Rosendale. And so one of the other industries that grew up because you had cement, you needed a way to move cement. And so you had coopers. So these are, I believe, these are the Lawrence cement factory guys. But these are coopers. And you had dry coopers and wet coopers. A cooper is a person who makes barrels. And a cement cooper had to be a wet cooper. That is, he had to make a barrel that was watertight, because your cement was no good if it got wet. And you're moving it on a canal. So these barrels had to be as tight as anything your whiskey is aged in, or your wines or whatever. Another local product that had prominence in the 19th century was millstones made from Schoengrum conglomerate. There was a company called the Esopus Millstone Company, and so these stones became known as Esopus stones. We discovered one, that one on the left, I've got a better picture of it. So here are some of the stone cutters in the St. Joseph area of the town of Rochester, just south of High Falls, was a spot where they rolled them down the hill to the canal right there, where berm road. So very often, by the way, when you see driving along a berm road or towpath road or canal road, if you look around, you'll probably see remnants of the canal somewhere. And this is a great time of year to do that, because when the trees aren't leafed out, you can pick out a lot of the of what's left of it, what's extant. And this is actually a bound millstone that was found right on the Five Locks Walk. In fact, it's still there. We're trying to get, the guy broke his machine trying to get it last winter. It's heavy, but that's one of the local stones that's on our Five Locks Walk property that we want to get up, get it to the museum one of these days. Cordwood. So here's a boat loaded up with just various wood products. It was another one of as I say, in the first 2 years, they carried more of this than coal, probably because they couldn't get enough coal out of Carbondale into Honesdale until they got the Gravity Railroad up and running. They also carried salt, flour, gypsum, bark, both for tanners and for whatever, hoops for barrels, hay, molasses, shingles, staves, brick, iron casting, marble, millstones, cotton, cement, as we've already said, plaster, leather, glass. There was a famous glassworks in Ellenville that shipped its products out on the canal. Again, here you've got this highway, you've got a means to move products, so industries would grow up where you had the requisite materials. We had millstone material in St. Joseph, so they started making stones there. You had cement in Rosendale. You had they must have had the right products to make the glass in Ellenville. So one of the other problems, if you've got a canal, is keeping water in it. And this is from the 1885 very famous break at Bolton Basin. So this is, I believe in the background, that is one of the aqueducts that I'll discuss a little later. But here you can see a devastating break occurred. I believe it was because of heavy rainfall. But amazingly enough, I think it took them 3 weeks to get it up and running. They spent a substantial amount of money to get it going. But and here again, here's a similar picture of that same break. But they had various smaller, they'd have little sections. I mean, this was particularly bad, but they had sections where they'd lose water. It was an ongoing thing. And in particular, because they kept enlarging the canal. And here's just a bucolic here in Rosendale, waiting for a pull. I don't know what happened to his team. It begs the question. In High Falls, so, you know, it never occurred to me until I got interested in canal lore that you wouldn't just float your boats into your streams. You couldn't. You'd lose all your water. Here you are fighting to keep water in the darn thing so that to make it profitable. In High Falls, they built a Roman-style aqueduct that's pictured here that serviced the canal from 1825 until... Oh, I think it was about 1850. They kept enlarging, so they had that 20-foot wide, where the boats were, I believe, 9.5 feet wide. Those 130-ton boats become 90 feet long and 14.5 feet wide. And all of a sudden, the locks, which were only 10 foot wide, weren't big enough, and they did major rebuilding. But fascinating. It must have been amazing to be in a boat going over the creeks. I forget the exact numbers of, I don't think I wrote it down, of, but anytime you had a waterway, you had some sort of aqueduct. Most of them were small wood-lined trunks with masonry piers, but here they had a much longer stretch. This one was so strong and built of that Rosendale cement again, probably mined in High Falls, that when they tried to demolish it in the early 60s, the wrecking ball bounced right off it, and they finally had to resort to dynamite. I guess it was an attractive nuisance. It's a darn shame that they couldn't have just fenced it off and kept it, because it would have been amazing to still have it. As it is, we own the property around it, and you can barely tell where it was. You can kind of make out man-made activity either side, but it's completely gone. You can, however, see either side of it closer, the remains of the later aqueduct, which we'll get to. So in 1847, they've expanded the locks, as I already said. Actually, it says the prism 32 foot wide, but by the final enlargement, 32 feet would barely let two 15 foot boats pass side by side. Canal had to be wide enough for boats, single boat either direction. It winds up almost at 48 feet wide, and it goes from 4 feet deep, they go to five and a half, and eventually 6 feet deep with a width of 48 to 52 feet on the top. Now, of course, again, all of the locks only took a single boat. Again, think about how much water. People always ask me when I'm doing a tour of the Five Locks Walk why it was only, I think, 3 or 6 inches either side of the boat and the walls. Well, you didn't want to waste any of that water. You made it just big enough for the boats to go through. So John Roebling becomes on the radar. He built a suspension aqueduct on one of the, I believe, Pennsylvania canals already. He builds a total of 4 suspension aqueducts for the D&H Company starting at about 1847. One over the Laxawaxen, one over the Delaware at Laxawaxen, one over the Neversink River in Cuttybackville, and then one over the Rondout. And in fact, that picture above Mr. Roebling's head there is High Falls now with the Roebling Aqueduct, and behind it you can see the Roman-style stone aqueduct. And off to that left is one of the 3 or 4 mills that were along the Rondout Creek using that water power from the falls. And here is, I believe this is going over the bridge of the Neversink, but I could be wrong. So here's a boat going over the aqueduct. And this is interesting. This is now on Route 213 looking north. The Roebling Aqueduct is above. That building right that you can see right in the dead center would be what they call a gear house. So by the 1859, they went around to one lock tender, and that's because somebody invented machinery so a guy could sit in one spot and operate the gates on either end of the lock, whereas before there were mechanical locks on both sides. The canal company had to jump at it, probably one of the last big improvements, because they could cut the payroll in half, couldn't they? They built houses for the lock tenders at every lock, all on the same pattern. I think John Jervis designed those houses, in fact. But this here on the right, there was another great improvement that came through, I believe, 1845, 1846, but certainly by 1850, the telegraph. And the D&H company immediately embraces this technology and, in fact, has them build a telegraph line from Albany all the way to Honesdale. And so when they hit the Rondout, they ran it right along there right away along the canal banks. So that building on the right there is a telegraph house, and it's still extant in High Falls. In fact, we're trying to get it. The county has a lien on it. I've got to get the extant relative to sign off on just donating it. It's in 1852 shape, I believe was the year it was finally finished. It's a building that hasn't changed. It's on a property that has no other use but ours. It's too small a property. But they were a very forward thinking company. Problem with the telegraph is later they would control the boatmen. So guys would be buying these boats from the company, having money taken out of their loads. And depending on what the market was doing and how much coal they had stockpiled, they'd make the lock tenders. They'd telegraph down the line and say, hold up the boats. And so guys that thought they could get 12 trips in a season, all of a sudden the company wouldn't let them. It was not a happy place for, you know, it was a tough life. We're going to be doing a show this at the D&H Museum this summer on the plight of the common man in the canal era and the common canal worker. We feel like it hasn't been spoken about enough. So here you can see there on the left is the style of a lock gate. You know, they've got the dates of 1850 and the post. I'm not sure if this was Wakefield or Ed Leroy, two of the historians that wrote these books. We have the patent copy in our offices, and I swear it's 1859, I'm going to say, if not 69 even, but I'm thinking 59. But I think it was later that the improvement of the single lock, but you can see there's on the right, there's the, well, there we go, 1859, the patent's right in front of me. Yeah, so I don't know where they got the 1850 date. It wasn't until 1859 that they actually had this technology. So this is what it was like before that. You can see you just had two gates either side, and one man would operate one side of it, and one man would operate the other. I think this might be a drawing from the Erie, but. And so there is the gear house. Here's looking down one of the locks, and there's a boat on its way down. So this is a boat that's dropping level. From the looks of it, it's a light boat, so this must be going towards Honesdale, I'm going to say. But there's the gear house right at the end of the lock, that where the one lock tender could sit and control the works. And they could do it in like 15 minutes. There's records of guys having 100 boats locked through in a day and stuff. And most of the canal had a towpath just on one side. So you had the berm side, and as I say, it wasn't a berm. Very often it was just the side of the road. In fact, on Berm Road in High Falls, you'll see sections where the road is sitting in the middle of the canal bed, but there's still 1825 stonework on the left that was the berm side of the canal. And then the towpath on a man-made berm is on the side, on the Rondout Creek side. And if you think about it, it was really amazing, the engineers, when they laid out the route, they had to figure out where they could keep it water level for the longest amount of time. And so you picked your route completely based on the idea. So you might make twists and turns because you didn't want to have an unnecessary lock. As I say, it's why they didn't go through the Shawangun Mountains. That would have required too many locks. It's why they didn't build a canal through the Moosic Mountains, because it would have taken too many locks to do it. So. And then the other thing, as I say, in 1850 or thereabouts, they're finally up to these 130-ton boats. And these boats are actually strong enough, some of them. As I read now, some of them weren't. But they started making the boats sturdy enough that they could raft together a bunch of them and not have to unload them in Rondout. So the canalers would just go, and it was probably a little bit of a busman's holiday, a little bit of a brief respite in their life, because they'd raft together and just get pulled by steamboats down to New York City. So for a couple days up and back, you'd be, so the canal company hired steamboats to pull many, many of these boats all at once, as many as they could, no doubt. But this is a very famous etching that's in the, I'm gonna say, is it the 1872 Ulster County Atlas? Much like that picture of the Fitch Building is also from that atlas. This is the Mary Powell by the Highlands on its way with some D&H Canal boats on their way to New York City. Interesting to note, there's still an awful lot of river sloops there too. And this would be after 1850, given what, I don't know when the Mary Powell came in. Probably there's somebody here that knows. So here's the Paymaster steam launch. As I say, they wouldn't run steamboats. In fact, towards the end of its life, they talked about having different motive power and even having a railroad on the canal bed. You know, they had a right of way. They had this water level route where they could be very easy to lay a train on it. So they even thought about having trains pull boats. But the fact is, you couldn't pull them any faster than 3 miles per hour without losing your canal. The erosion would eventually just wreak havoc. So there were only one or two steam launches. Repair crews sometimes had them, and this was the paymaster's boat, because there was a man who would go up and down the canal and pay the lock tenders along the entire route. But so the canal company, you know, recognizes railroads had, in 1850, it was still twice as expensive to carry coal on a railroad as it was the canal. By 1870, that reverses, and railroads can operate year-round, pretty much, whereas the canal, the canals up north here had an 8-month season if they're lucky. And in fact, you know, it's in the D&H Canal Company was very, the Wurtz brothers were religious men, and so they donated land always for churches along. And famously, the D&H Canal, it's in the lore that they never worked on Sunday. And I've had this quoted to me by people doing tours of the museum. The fact is, actually, there were times when they would work on Sundays, in particular at the end of the season, getting that last load in before the canal iced up. You know, if you didn't get your boat to round out by the time the canal freezes up, your boat wasn't going anywhere. The coal you were responsible for was stuck on that. And if you didn't stay on it, somebody was going to come get it. In fact, there's a lot of stories. Kids used to harass the canalers so that they'd throw coal at them, and then they'd go and they'd recover that coal when they drained it down in the winter. And in fact, there was so much coal that got lost in the canal that during miner strikes in the 1870s, 1880s, they actually mined, tons and tons out of the bed down Sullivan County or Orange County way, down in the southern end. There was so much coal that just either through, possibly because breaks like that one in the Bolton Basin, so much coal wound up in the coal bed that they were actually, for a while, were able to pull it up out of the bed. But the locals would also take advantage. As they say, they'd harass the canalers, they'd throw the coal at them, and they'd collect the coal, take it home, and burn it. The canal company also, they thought about putting railroads around their route, right along their route, but they actually kept the canal running until 1899. They pretty much never, they bought up railroads that increased their market. So they bought a railroad that went up to Albany and up through Lake George into the St. Lawrence Seaway so that they could then move their coal up that away. But by about 1870, 1880, they stopped putting much money, the canal becomes a, they maintain it, but they, but in fact, one of the presidents aggressively knew, saw the writing on the wall. They start buying up railroads, and they know that eventually railroads are going to be the way to move goods to market, that the canaling days were numbered. So what we've got right here, so the canal, you know, so for the last 20 years, you've got mainly families running the boats. You've got the canal company regulating how much coal. So even if you're the hardest working guy on the canal, if they won't let you, if they're telling their lock tenders not to lock you through, you aren't going anywhere. So by 1899, they closed down the Gravity. This is famously the last boat. So here's the Napanock. It was a reformatory at the time. Now it's a correctional facility. All of the brick for this building was brought along the canal. And in fact, on their property, there's a little bridge, Decker's Bridge, that is somewhat like a bridge that was over the canal. They've got, on that property, there is some of the canal route. But this is famously is the last boat running down the canal in 1899. In fact, the canal doesn't completely end. Samuel Coykendall, who was the son-in-law of Samuel Cornell, the famous steamboat entrepreneur, if you will, also had his hand in railroads, I think. Coykendall bought the D&H Canal from High Falls to Rondout and operated it probably, the books say 5 or 6, 7 years. I hear anecdotally even longer, possibly as late as even 1907, 1908, 1909. It was still, they ran it to run more of that Rosendale cement to Rondout. Rosendale cement doesn't really get supplanted by Portland cement until about the same time, I'm going to say, at the turn of the 20th century. So here it is. This is a view. I had somebody at the museum during the season this year who remembered that they used to have, you see all these boats lined up. This has got to be an off season. This is Rondout. But in fact, I think that might be the offices to the far right there. I'm not sure. There were boats like this in the Rondout waterfront in the mid-1950s. And the Army Corps of Engineers was finally told to go, and they burned them all. What a shame, They had these boats extant for 50 years just sitting there. But on the other hand, they're 15 feet wide and 90 feet long. I'd love to have them, but I don't know how we'd get it anywhere, how we'd take care of it, what we'd do with it. It's a crying shame. I found it mind-boggling to think that they actually had, that they lasted that long, that they were there. And then to think that they burned them, that they couldn't think of another, that they couldn't at least pull one out and do something with it, just seems a real waste. But, the whole... it's not until about 1960 that all of a sudden people start to appreciate that they had this amazing technology that informed the history of all the towns along its route. In the name of progress, nobody thought much of it for those first 50 or 60 years of the 20th century. And it's a shame that so much of it is in private hands now. We're very lucky, and I'll get to that in the end of my talk here, that Orange and Sullivan County own virtually all of the canal route. But here in Ulster, a lot of it's in private hands, most of it. So here is famously a newspaper. They're saying November 5th, 1898. It's funny because the books sometimes say 1899, but here, according to this, one prized cargo weighed 150 tons, huh? There's another one. And again, you get a good look at here. Here's the slide, the sophistication of the rail cars on the top and gravity feeding. You know, it was rough, hard work. And so there the basin right there, and with the rail cars off to the side there. But look at that prosperous village off to the left there. That all came about. There was nothing anywhere. Contemporary accounts, there's a guy by the name of John Johnston who wrote a great book. It's hard to find because it's the history of the, I think, Minisink Valley. It doesn't come up. The Minisink Historical Society sells it, but not as a D&H history. But this guy relates seeing surveying crews come through by his house in 1825, and the kids playing surveyor later, and lived. So he writes this book in like 1901 and talks about the entire history. So we have great contemporary accounts of the things that went along the canal from a very colorful character, too, I've got to say. Yeah. So one of the things that I find really interesting and fun, we live with so much of this still extant. In fact, one of the seasonal shows I'd like to do, and this is a little bit of a give you an idea of what it might be like, is then and now. So much of it's still extant. Now, this is creek locks from the Roundout Creek today. There is that right along Creek Locks Road. There was a dry dock right next to one of the locks. I think there's the second lock in from Tidewater. It's actually a little confusing too, because there's the last Tidewater lock on Creek Locks Road, but then lock number one is actually by that restaurant, right the other side of 213. Is it there by the bridge? There's yet another lock. They also had way locks. They had a way lock down in Hawley. They got into a deal in the mid-19th century where they started moving coal for another company, so they put in a way lock there. And way locks were locks that just let the water out, and there was a big scale at the bottom of it, and they would weigh the boat. So at the beginning of the boating season, they weighed the boats, so they knew the dry weight, the empty weight of all the boats. And then they had a way lock in Honesdale, and your last stop and Roundout was to the way lock, where they find out how much coal you still had on your boat by the time you got to Honesdale after throwing it at the kids. Or burning it yourself. They probably would have used it to cook with and stuff on the boats. So this is what Creek Locks looks like today. So if you're driving along Creek Locks Road, the property owners aren't very enthusiastic. It's private property, but you can look from the road. There's the one Tidewater lock, but the next one, I'm going to say south and or west, there's also the remains of a dry dock right there, because they built boats right there in Creek Locks, didn't they? So that's what it looked like. And here is what that same lock, I believe, looked like from the other side. But there it is, Creek Locks, New York, the lock in probably the latter part, the 1890s or so. Of course, I've got to push my own. If you haven't walked the five lock walk, it's really great. So these locks are atypical. So in 1850 or so, in high falls, some of those turns were so sharp, and in fact, when I give tours, it's dangerous, but right on 213, you can sit, and you can see the remains of these 1825 locks, and you can just see that by the way that they're situated, that there's no way a 90-foot boat could make that turn. They're just, it's impossible. They extensively rerouted in high falls and replaced some, I think, six or seven locks with five locks. So all these locks are 10-foot drop as opposed to the usual 8, and they're atypical in that they're dry-laid stone. And we were lucky enough to get some grants from the state back in the early 90s, and we were able to restore 4 out of the 5 of the locks. So this is looking down lock 16, right in front of the Depute Canal House, right in the middle of High Falls. That stone right there on the ground is actually the keystone from that Roman-style aqueduct in High Falls. When it was constructed, they had a Masonic ceremony and put a little time capsule with coins and things in it. In fact, Central Hudson now has the what was in that arch, because they were the ones that did the demolition of it. We're trying to get the contents given to us, because it would be a better home, we think. So these locks were all dry laid stone. So I'm told that the canalers didn't like High Falls towards the end of the season, because as you drop down the lock, those dry laid stone was tight, but water would come out of it. So on a cold day, you'd get water pouring out the locks, and it'd ice up the whole top of the boat. It was chilly stuff. High Falls was so busy, it was one of two points on the canal where both sides were towpaths. So there was a spot where animals could switch over There was a bridge in a spot where you'd have boats running one way on one side, boats running the other on the other, because there was these five locks in such close proximity, and they were so busy that they needed to have both sides. And in fact, the Depute Canal House, you can see on the corner, it would be off to our right here in this picture, where they, for whatever reasons, the canalers took the boat rope around the edge of the building, and they dug these deep grooves with the wet, sandy ropes. You know, all of these locks have what we call snubbing posts. They're four posts made of, I'm told, Binny Water sandstone, which I'm told was used because it resisted splitting. And you could tell lock snubs because they all have these really deep grooves worn into them from the canalers running the rope out, that wet, sandy rope in and out. It just cut. You can put your finger in them. There's a lock snub that I discovered on the O&W rail trail in Marbletown, the other side of the Rondout Creek from High Falls and from the canal, that the railroad, when it took over and bought some of the right-of-ways, repurposed a lot of the snubbing posts as mile markers. And so we got permission, just before Irene came and a tree went down. It's a good thing I knew where it was and got the permissions, because we would have lost it. It was on the side of the rail trail. It was town property, so they gave us permission to get it. And it was clearly, when you see them, you get clearly a lock snub. It's now in front of the lock tender shanty that's in front of our canal museum. And you can see faintly the mile markers. And in fact, it was within 30 feet of the signs that the rail trail committee had put up with the same mile marks from Kingston and Ellenville on them, you know. So let's see, that's High Falls. And this is what High Falls looked like. There's the Depute Canal House. There's the gear house there. This is what it looked like once again. And that's a full boat coming through. And that makes sense. You can tell whether it's a light boat or a full boat by obviously how it's sitting in the water. And here's another view of that same lock now, looking down at the same as that first picture. The great thing is, if you're at all inclined, we've got a lot of places. So those of you who know the town of Accord on Towpath Road, the Peterskill comes through and joins the roundout. Here's the bridge over the Peterskill. And here's the aqueduct, the D&H aqueduct that went over the same spot. And in fact, when you drive along that road on your left, if you look carefully, you can see the feeder canal. It's about, I'm going to say, 8 foot wide that they used to pull water off the Peterskill to fill. There was Davis Basin would be to your left in this picture. There was one of the many basins along the canal route that we're trying to get water back in it. I fear we won't manage to do it, but because they put a road in the way, and now that feeder doesn't feed what it was supposed to. But this is another spot you can see. Here, further down on that road, on my actually on the Schoonmaker property, Alice Schoonmaker, the president, I think, of the Town of Rochester Historical Society and one of the trustees of the D&H, this is the Stonykill Aqueduct. Hart, you can see it around this time of year. You can just see it from the road as you drive along. So I was asked recently to write an article for that same paper. The Accordion is the journal of the Historical Society of Rochester, and they wanted something on the D&H, and they suggested a topic that I didn't think was going to be very interesting. As it is, the town of Rochester, right in Accord, has a 3-mile rail trail, and it's the New York O&W rail trail, but it runs absolutely. In 1900, the New York O&W ran a spur of their railroad from Wurtzboro to Kingston, I believe it was, largely along for that earlier length of the D&H bed. So their rail trail happens to also be on the D&H canal. And there were some wonderful signs, I can remember some of them. You can see the remains vandalized of what was a self-guided tour pointing out the various features of the canal and the railroad that were on it. But they're all gone. So I've written an article, and those of you who might get the Accordion, in the March issue, I've written a self-guided tour of that 3 miles, telling you the various features as best I can make them out and from what I can tell from the literature. So this is actually a view of the Mountain Brook Aqueduct. I'm actually trespassing because I'm off the rail trail now, but I had to look at the stonework they had to build. This is where they built one of those wood trunk-lined aqueducts over one of the many, many waterways on its way to the Rondout Creek. So the far side of this, the Rondout Creek, is way opposite. So where we're looking, if I'd taken the shot from the middle of the Mountain Brook, you could see the Rondout through there. You can also, when you look at this, if you ever happen to hike this, look down and you'll notice that the bed of the stream underneath where the aqueduct had been is lined with wood parallel to the flow of the water. And I know from my reading that John Jervis figured this out for when they built aqueducts on the Erie. And I think, and this is just my surmise, that it kept debris from getting stuck on anything. If you had rocks and stuff, debris was going to build up and you were going to have a problem. But by laying down boards on the bottom, and because they're underwater all the time, they don't rot. They probably used hemlock, or they probably used a somewhat rot-resistant wood. But you can, to this day, see, and in fact, this is a railway bridge that was built over the aqueduct. The railway bridge spans almost twice the distance that the original D&H aqueduct spanned. But you can look down and tell exactly what the original width was by these boards that run underneath the bed of the stream. And again, you know, these guys were figuring it out. We, the School of Engineering in America basically develops from Erie Canal guys who then go on to work on other canals and then go on to work on railroads. And guys like Jervis who then also did things like aqueducts and water supplies like the Croton Reservoir. So this is a view a little further south on that same rail trail at the southern terminus of it. And if you see that stonework over there, there's speculation that there was a dock over there. You got to figure all these trees were gone throughout the whole 19th century. There wasn't a tree along the entire bed. So there are other, we're very lucky if any of you are inclined to go and examine other parts of the D&H Canal that are extant. We've got, besides the ones I've just shown you there, going south on 209, when you cross into Sullivan County, because Sullivan County owns the entire canal bed, on your right there's at Bova Road, the linear park. They've recently got a government grant and they restored, there's a dry dock there, there's two locks, and there's a museum that's open, I think just weekends in the season. A little museum, they're starting, they're not as lucky as to have been in business as long as we have and don't have the collections that we've got, but they're getting there. But there's a whole section of canal you can hike, a good mile and a half right there. Further down 209, you'll see right on your left past there, I'm gonna say a mile and a half, just a parking area, there's no signs or anything, and there's a big long stretch of the canal filled with water, and you know, there's nothing like a man-made canal. You can't mistake it for a stream because it's dead straight, the same width the entire thing, but you can hike that 3 or 4 or 5 miles along there. My wife and I have dogs and tend to hike a lot of the local places that we've got. Further down then, it's south of the town I think it's south of Wurtzboro, on the left is the Hornbeck Basin, which again, there's a rail trail and it's hard to make out the canal stuff that's left there, but you can hike along there. And then the Bashakill area at Haven Road, right next to 209, you can take Haven Road and park, and there's, I'm gonna say, 4 miles of canal bed, but you can also go down and, I forget the name, there's two other spots that you can park. One of them is on the maps of the hiking areas. And you can get up onto the canal bed and hike 3 or 4 miles. I only got as far as the hunters' trucks when my wife and I and the dog said we're going to wait till it's not hunting season to go from here. So I'm on my spring trips I'm going to go hike that section because it's one section I haven't gotten to see. And then further south of there, right by the Neversink Area Museum, just before the Neversink, there's the remains of the roaming aqueduct there. And there's a museum there, and there's a basin and a park and another, I'm going to say, maybe a mile section that's a park that you can hike and see, walk right on the towpath. And actually Orange County, my colleague and the president of the DHTHC has got an organization where they've been cleaning up vast sections of the Orange County owned D&H and making it available. Cliff Robinson Jr. is his name. So that's sections that are publicly available for all of you if you're interested in seeing what's left of the canal. But you can also, just driving along Berm Road on the way to Ellenville, if you take a turn off, wherever you see the word port, you know, you just got to scratch your head and say, you know, where's the river? All these towns, Kerhonkson was known as Port Jackson. There was a Port Ben, Port Jervis. It wasn't a port on the Delaware. It was Port Jervis, named for John Jervis. It was Carpenter Point prior to that. In fact, so there's many, many places, and I'm yet, it's on my bucket list to go down to Pennsylvania. I know there's sections of that run of the canal that you can also explore in many great cultural institutions along there as well. So I'm at the point now where if there's any questions or anything that I didn't make clear enough, Sure. You know, I'm not placing exactly, it may not have been canal related. I mean, people did a lot of different stuff. You know, I read a statistic when they were trying to restore stream beds to their original historic places. In the first 100 years of European settlement in America, they dammed 5,000 streams. So a lot of our waterworks have been monkeyed with. It took me a long time to figure out. I remember I was walking down by the Rondout in High Falls one day, and somebody asked me about what I thought was part of the canal, but in fact was the mill race. But it's confusing in High Falls because we have two different routes there that you have to learn to pick out. Every time I drive through and hike these things, I learn another bit of the history. But without seeing your specific section, it doesn't sound like something that's...
It's not a river.
Yeah. Well, you know, they did. You could see from those pictures of the Rondout that how many boats in the off season. Very often, you know, you wound up in the off season. You're racing the ice. You're working on Sundays, even though the God fearing men of the canal. It has the reputation as being the only canal that closed on Sundays regularly, and that was apparently largely the Wurtz brothers. Although it's interesting too, because historically the Wurtz brothers both were involved with the canal company, but one of the brothers was a Pennsylvania legislator early on, and then he was probably their most successful president. John was the third Wurtz brother to have a big effect. But they had to do a lot of, you know, the end of the season, all those boats wound up parked there. So they may have made concessions. I mean, they built Island Dock. They had a way lock there. And then they had all those facilities. They added mechanical loaders towards the end of it. But again, I'm not placing the exact spot. Yeah. Oh, you know, see, on the Hudson. So they may have. So somebody may have built a dock there, but without doing some more research. But that's the wonderful thing. There's a lot we don't know still. Certainly, there's. You know, I was being put up as an expert, but I've read all the books numerous times. But there's too much to know for me. I'm a little like, you know. There was a little adverse possession, but I think by and large they purchased. I mean, some of the guys, even the Wurtz brothers, bought. Well, first off, they had David Nobles running around buying up land in their name, so nobody knew what they were doing. They bought land when they were thinking about making extensions, because they thought about extending out when the Pennsylvania Coal Company started adding their tonnage. In the 1860s and 70s, the Pennsylvania Coal Company shipped more coal on the D&H Canal than the D&H did, and there's a very famous litigation because they had a deal that the Pennsylvania coal people were supposed to pay a certain amount based on how much more tonnage they could move because of the improvements, and they refused to do it, claimed it never happened, and it's a very famous and huge volumes. It's, I forget how many books. I haven't even started to crack the litigation. As I understand it, the best thing about these books is that they took testimony from a lot of the canalers. In fact, I'll be looking into it for our show coming up in July, because it may be a really great source of anecdotal stuff for the workers, but, you know. But the canal company owned, well, you know, there was nothing there, so they bought up. It was easy for them to buy this worthless land from people, and then they would sell it on speculation, so they made money when people wanted to build towns there. But they also donated many of the churches. You look at Rondout as a town of churches. I mean, Rondout would not be, was it the second biggest town in the state in the mid-19th century? Something crazy like that, or in the county. It was a big town, and that was all the D&H is doing. I mean, Rondout proper was, well, it was the Strand before the D&H came through, and I guess it was part of Kingston, but it became its own town, and then I don't know the exact date, but it became part of Kingston. But really, in a certain way, the Rondout was a bigger deal than the town of Kingston, because, and all of it because of the canal. But any of those towns along that route would not be here. And in fact, most of them have smaller populations now than they did in the 19th century. It was their heyday. You know, you go look at a town like Ellenville and go, wow, you know. But they don't get into that a lot as far as I'm. I know that from my reading that they use the phrase, so that must have occasionally done it. But there wasn't a lot of, it wasn't like you were taking somebody's home. You were taking farmland, you know. They had to do things like build bridges So when I was trying to figure out the town of Accord, I walked along that all the time, and I would see these stones up on the side, and there was even the signs that there was a sign there. It took me the longest time to realize that those were the footings for a bridge. And then you looked and you realized there was, I don't know, 10 or 20 acres of farmland that was going to be completely canal locked, and so the canal company had to put a bridge there. They had to make it so that people still had access to their lands. But I think by and large they bought more than condemned, you know. Any other questions? Yeah.
There's a large body of boats associated with the Operation Immigrant. Do we have anything similar?
We do, and in fact, I can try and pull one or two up off of here. I think there are more with the Erie. That's some of the stuff we want to do for some of the events we're trying to do. I'd love to do we want to do a food in the time of the Canal Era event in July, the first weekend in July, for the opening of our show about every man, you know, the common canal worker in the 19th century. But certainly, yeah, there's some songs in the books. Actually, Dorothy Sanderson's book on the D&H Canal, the second edition, the hardcover, has got a bunch of songs in the end of it that are canal songs, some of them D&H.
So, thank you.
Oh, well, you know what, let me have...
Yep,
I think you take it from here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bill, thank you. Thank you very much. That was very interesting. And again, the D&H Canal has such an important role in our community. And one thing that Bill didn't bring up that the D&H Canal is responsible for, which may be even more important than everything else, the cement, the coal, the bluestone, is that legend has it that the peanut butter sandwich was invented in Ulster County as a result of the D&H Canal. The story is that there was a stop on the D&H Canal in Allegreville, and that the owner went down to the Caribbean where he encountered peanut butter, and which had been around for a long time. I guess it wasn't around up here. He loved it. I presume that they ate it out of bowls or something. He brought it back up here, and he thought, this was great. I'm going to sell this to all the canal workers who would come through his establishment. But what he found is that they were always on. They didn't have time to sit there and have a bowl of peanut butter. So he started putting it on bread, and voila, the peanut butter sandwich is invented. This is a legend. I don't know if it's true. I always tell...
What does it matter?
Exactly. I see something like that, I'm going to grab it for Ulster County. I always tell it to the students who come for tours through the courthouse, and for everything that's happened in the courthouse, the thing that they care about most is the peanut butter sandwich. So, the entire world owes all of us a great deal of gratitude for the D&H Canal. Yes, I actually did. When I heard this, I did some investigation, and apparently the jelly, the peanut butter and jelly sandwich, didn't originate until World War II. The GIs had tins of peanut butter, you had tins of jelly. They're the ones, apparently, from my research on, it was probably Wikipedia, so I don't know. This is what I had found, was that it became very common then. They switched them, they mixed them together, and they loved it, and voila. But I was hoping that the peanut butter and jelly sandwich started, but all I can really, the legend is only that the peanut butter sandwich developed here, so I don't want to overextend myself more than I already have. Yes? We thank you, and particularly Bill. And I have to say, this, much like all the speakers that we've had to this series, we'd picked the subject of the D&H Canal, certainly an appropriate subject. I don't really know who can do it, but I call up the D&H Canal Museum, I get Bill. Actually, I think I sent an email. Bill responded, and I explained what we were trying to do. Did he know anybody there who could help us out? He goes, yeah, I'll do it, sure. So everybody, Bill, thank you so much, and all of our speakers. I mean, everybody has been just wonderful, and Bill was like, yeah, this is great. Yeah, I'll put something together. Looking forward to it. Never asking when, or do I have to do this, or do I have to do that. He just said, Absolutely. Let me know when. So, in fact, we had to switch up the schedule at one point. I call up and said, you know, I don't know, do you have the ability to switch it? Sure. Sure, when do you want me? You tell me when, I'll be there. So, and it was a wonderful presentation. And I know you had more, so I apologize. I didn't mean to cut you off. I do want to, and I apologize, we want to go through it. We really want to, again, thank everybody who makes this possible.
Next slide.
Yep. Particularly Bill Merchant, again, he has. Bill has brought some information from the D&H Canal Museum out there with a schedule. Please pick it up. They have some wonderful programs. As you can tell, you got a small tidbit of the knowledge that he has and what they have available. So please partake. We also want to thank, again, the Senate House. They do so much for us. They are so generous to allow us to use the Senate House Museum for these presentations. Everybody here is absolutely wonderful. Bob Rizzo, who does all the videos, again, any video you want of any of our presentations, he has them. He has many of them in the back. If you can contact him or you can get some tonight. He does a wonderful job. All the people who publicize this event, many of you are here because of finding it in these different places. Hugh Reynolds always does a big spread on our presentations in the Kingston Times. It usually comes out the Friday after, so please pick up the Kingston Times next Friday, and he's always got a lot more in-depth information. He speaks to the presenters. All the people who publicize this on Facebook, we have Jillian Fisher, Walt Wachowski, Chester Hartwell, all these people, really, we owe them a debt of gratitude. Friends of Historic Kingston always puts us on their website. Ulster County Tourism, Kingston Community Radio, Kingston Happenings, the Daily Freeman Preview. We thank all of them for what they do for us. I want to thank Kingston's Buried Treasure for what they do here. We have a wonderful group. We have, as always, Ed Ford. We have Joe Tantillo, who puts everything together. Anything that looks good about our presentation, that's Joe. Anything that sounds good is me. Joe really does a wonderful job. Ann Gordon, Pat Murphy, Tom Hoffe, Nina Pasupak, a wonderful group, and you know, we're able to put on this presentation because of them. Again, as always, JK Wine and Liquor. They're the official sponsor of Kingston's Buried Treasure. We thank them. They always, they donate the wine. Gene tonight bought a bottle that I've heard rave comments about, but JK Wine and Liquor, they donate the wine that you have here tonight. So again, if you're gonna go get a bottle of something, go get it at JK's. And all of you, again, you make this worthwhile. We appreciate your love for history. We appreciate your support, and we're gonna keep doing it as long as you guys keep coming. So again, thank you for everything you do. And before we leave, I do once again wanna just highlight Ed Ford's Lunette Project. We've talked about it last time, but we have a few days left on the Indiegogo crowdfunding website. Many of you have contributed towards this, and we want to thank all of you for it. Ed has done so much for all of us that it really is an honor for everybody, all of us here, to be able to give something back to Ed. And one of the projects that's been near and dear to Ed's heart for many, many years is the replacement of the lunettes in the Common Council Chamber of City Hall. Joe, again, has made this wonderful display, this wonderful slide, but that's a picture of the lunette that is going to go up, dedicated to Ed Ford. It is the presentation of the wampum belt that ended the second Esopus Indian War, correct? So, again, everybody who contributed, we thank you. Anybody who would like to contribute, you can do it online for a few more days at Indiegogo. It's on there, and there we also have handouts. You just type in Ed Ford, and you can donate there. You can also make a check payable to City of Kingston and send it to me at the courthouse, 285 Wall Street in Kingston. We're just so happy that we're able to do this for Ed, and it is a very fitting thing to have up there for Ed for everything he's done. And before we leave, I just want to let everybody know the upcoming subjects of our series. We've talked a bit tonight about James McEntee. Perfect. Our next subject is the McEntee family. Lowell Thing is going to be our speaker on the McEntee family. Kingston's first family dynasty. That's on February 21st, again, 5:30 here. The McEntees have done unbelievable things. We talked tonight about James McEntee and everything that he did, and I believe he is the builder of Dock Island. John McEntee is, again, I think if you really could take one person who was responsible for the Battle of Gettysburg, it would be John McEntee, through his intelligence work with the Bureau of Military Information. You also have Jervis McEntee and Julia McEntee Dillon. You know, very famous painters. So Lowell Thing is going to tell us all about the McEntee clan. And on March 11th, we are going to do a presentation on the Old Dutch Church, probably the signal building in our community. And we all, since the founding of Kingston, the Old Dutch has really been the place by which everything evolved. So it's really one of the most monumental buildings in our community, and it really is a fitting subject for our presentation. So again, we hope to see you February 21st for our next presentation on the McEntees. All right, again, thank you everybody. Have a wonderful weekend. We'll see you next month.